Hi, I'm George Dahl. Welcome back once again to my film journal. Let's take a moment here to eulogize and remember and relive a very, very important American teenage ritual. And that, of course, is the drive-in theater movie phenomenon, right? This was a mainstay of American teenage entertainment back in the 60s and 70s and 80s when our parents were coming up. And as it pertains to the film we're talking about today and its studio, it was a full-blown business model. So let's grab a six-pack of beer, throw your friend in the trunk of your Ford Pinto, hook up that AM radio sound system, and let's talk about a movie that existed solely to be ignored by teenagers who are making out in their cars. I'm talking about Crown International Pictures' 1978 film, Van Nuys Boulevard.
Where are you going?
Van Nuys Boulevard.
When?
Now!
Let's have some time for our hit song. Now, if you were fortunate enough to be around in the halcyon days when the Barnes & Noble DVD section was the mecca for film fans, then you've probably seen this DVD, which, of course, upon inspection, you would assume to be filled with trash. But to a couple of drunk college kids and his buddies like me, it was actually a collection of solid gold. What you found in this package was a jumble of early releases by Crown International Pictures. Crown International Pictures was an independent studio that specialized in mostly schlock B-movies, like The Creeping Terror and The Land of the Minotaur with Peter Cushing. Films that usually went straight to the drive-in theaters. The company was started by a guy named Newton P. Jacobs, who was a former higher-up at RKO, and under his auspices, the company found middling success. But in 1973, Mark Tenser was promoted to head of production after marrying Red's daughter, Marilyn. Together, the couple scrapped most of the monster horror genre in favor of films that appealed to teens, like Super Chick and The Van. These movies were titillating, fun, and aimed directly at the youth. These so-called Beach Bunny pictures had been dead since the early 1960s, but with the success of Lucas's American Graffiti, a film that heavily influenced Van Nuys Boulevard, the couple saw their in, producing films like The Pom Pom Girls for less than $1 million and raking in more than $4 million in 1976. My friends and I found that Crown International Pictures actually hit their stride with a thematic trilogy of films often featuring similar cast members, which started with The Pom Pom Girls and Malibu Beach and, of course, Van Nuys Boulevard. These movies, I would say, were the prototype, or they anticipated the popularity of more mainstream acceptable fare in the 1990s, like Dazed and Confused, of course, or I Can't Hardly Wait, or American Pie. Van Nuys Boulevard follows the adventures of five young thrill seekers who are brought together by their love of cars, sex, beer, and fast food. They're out on the prowl to party or race cars, and the nexus for their lifestyle is cruise night on Van Nuys Boulevard in California. Bobby, played here by Crown Pictures regular Will Adler, our lead, is a wayward youth obsessed with proving his skills and the integrity of his souped-up van.
Say, what you got in that hunk of junk?
I got more than you can handle.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Meet you on Raymer.
What's a Raymer?
It's a street, dummy.
It's where everybody drags. You ready?
Yeah, sure.
Which leads him to race against fellow van enthusiasts Moon and Camille, an exploit that lands both of them in jail. Victims of the overenthusiastic bad guy cop, Zass, who is chronically obsessed with disrupting teenage self-actualization and an overall fun-hater, a familiar foil in films like these. Fortunately, Zass gets his comeuppance when he tries to goad Wanda, the drive-in waitress, into sex and is then handcuffed to his own car. The film cuts back to Zass's predicament four times as his morale and condition slowly deteriorate throughout the film. In He also busts and or traps the Chooch, the silver screen antecedent to Matthew McConaughey's David Wooderson.
Hey, nobody calls Chooch a creep, man.
What?
Nobody calls Chooch a creep, man.
Don't be a hero.
An older townie who can't let go of his youth, he being the only character who hasn't ditched his hot rod for a super cool van. I can't be the only one who sat through this film and thought a few minutes in, what the hell is up with these vans? And I suppose that's a corner of culture that has been preserved in an anthropological fashion by this film, Van Nuys Boulevard. Along with the cool cars, there's plenty of sex and titillation to be had, of course, which is a hallmark of the Crown formula. The hapless Greg is introduced pining for one of the many beautiful women who flock to cruise night, as his daydreaming is rudely interrupted by a pugnacious jock. After their disagreement escalates to the point of destruction, in a low point, he's left on a curb, only to be picked up by a glamorous biker chick. And taken back to a flophouse / drug den for some amorous lovemaking, with enough uncomfortable mouth and eye close-ups to make you reevaluate the human body. Amazingly, this sequence is the least unpleasant sexual liaison that Greg encounters in the movie, as his insatiable appetite for sex, which borders on addiction, leads him to dressing up like a woman in order to sleep with Camille, only once again to be thwarted in that pursuit by her father, who mistakes the cross-dressing Greg for a sexy lady. What?
Camille!
Camille? Mildred!
Okay, well, after being barraged with scenes like this, you'd assume it couldn't get any worse, but you didn't realize that the maniacs at Crown International Pictures hypothesized sexual situations like the writers of Saw devised torture schemes. And for those of you who like a little ketchup and mustard with your lovemaking, there is even a scene for you. Right, so what is happening here?
I will try.
Well, my friends, this is a very targeted and covert attempt to sell you fast food from a concession stand. No, for real. The Tensors were nothing if not savvy business people. They realized that the most important thing they could do to get their movies booked was to throw a bone to the theater owners. The same theater owners who in the late 70s reaped most of their profits from their concession stands. Hence the forced inclusion of eating in many of the Crown pictures.
A little more
sauce. Sure, why not?
All right.
You like that?
Yeah.
One more. How's that?
It's great.
Good. Wonderful around.
The idea was to offer a movie that would bring in kids with a little TNA, hijinks, etc., and also make them hungry for snacks.
How you doing? What took you so long? I'm really hungry.
You'll notice that I've been rather vague on my discussion of the plot, and for the most part, there is not one. After our characters are thrown into jail together, they decide to spend the next day at an amusement park. Then they go for some disco dancing and entertainment by a group called the Kansas City Glitter Girls.
Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the Kansas City Glitter Girls.
They race go-karts, they play video games, and then they go to the beach, where Greg accidentally releases a pig to wreak havoc on the beachgoers, having mistaken the pig's motion in the vehicle for the gyrations of a sexual engagement. Lest he be left out, he opens the door. After all, we've established Greg as a sex maniac. What we have here is all fairly innocuous lights and sounds, directionless jokes and gags that can be passively engaged with an audience who is caught between makeout sessions. The couples start to pair off. Greg, who is a manipulative sexual deviant, somehow convinces Camille to fall for him. Chooch and Wanda. Wanda, who's sort of spacey-eyed and obviously the weirdest and would probably end up falling for somebody like Chooch. They bond over his happening pad and car. And Bobby and Moon engage in a sort of combative relationship and jealousy between her and his van.
All this? What in the hell are you doing? Rebuilding your engine?
Will you come on, Moon?
I mean, will you just lay off, huh?
Which culminates in his rejection of the van racing lifestyle in a dramatic bid to prove his devotion to her.
Oh my God! Bobby! Bobby, I didn't mean it!
Surprisingly though, and maybe it's not apparent on the surface, but even with all the blatant sex and nudity, the film does provide a bit of gender parity. That is, equality of power between the men and women in the film. From Wanda's clever subduing of Zaz to Moon's toughness, driving skills, and commanding nature, the boys and girls are good foils for one another. This isn't necessarily a male-oriented sex comedy like Revenge of the Nerds or Porky's. Here, sex is for everyone, and that was partly due to the influence of Marilyn Tenser. So all is well at the end. And then, as a coda, we see that Zass has been completely mentally broken by his traumatic experience.
Well, Zass, more trouble?
Hi, guys.
Cue the credits. It's sometimes an uncomfortable experience watching these films when you see actors that you don't recognize. People who obviously went out to LA and hit just adjacent to stardom. The most famous actor to come out of all of these movies is probably Robert Carradine from the Pom Pom Girls, who ended up playing the dad on Lizzie McGuire. Obviously, there's an exploitative element here, what with all the women taking their clothes off. There's not much future in that. What became of all these people? I guess I just assume that most of these actors left Hollywood and went back home to Ohio or wherever to live out normal, inconspicuous lives, where their involvement in a 1970s schlock teen picture would be brought up at company meetings or cocktail parties as an interesting curio. Either that or they died of a drug overdose or something else, which is sadly familiar in Hollywood. Even stars like Veronica Lake suffered this tragic fate, relegated to obscurity, serving drinks in a dingy bar, their looks having faded by alcohol and the crushing demands of a tough industry. This fate actually befell one of the actors that we know of in the Crown Pictures community, Rainbow Smith from the Pom Pom Girls. She went on to act in a few roles after her appearance in that film, but then developed a heroin addiction and died on the street of hepatitis. In the case of David Hayward, who plays Chooch, I find his career peculiar. It started off incredibly strong with his playing a major role in Robert Altman's acclaimed Nashville. He was even on the poster. And he was also the voice of the son on what looks like a proto-Family Guy, Simpsons-style adult animated series that ran for 2 seasons primetime on CBS. But since then, he's worked steadily on TV shows like Jag and Remington Steele. The same is the case with Dennis Bowen, who died in 2012. The guy had lots of guest spots on TV shows, having appeared in over 100 of them, and according to his obituary, he was in over 1,000 commercials, like this McDonald's ad for Filet-O-Fish. Cynthia Wood, who plays Moon, was actually Playboy Playmate of the Year in 1974, and to my shock, is actually in Apocalypse Now, playing one of the touring playmates, whose role is extrapolated upon in the director's cut. She tried her hand at singing, performing the title song for a Japanese anime film from 1982, Golgo 13 The Professional. And since then, she's gotten her PhD in psychology and lives out her days, assumably, in that profession. Melissa Prophet went on to star in some 1980s action films like Invasion USA, and most famously, she played Joe Pesci's wife in Casino, the one who smuggles diamonds in her hair. It's tough to find information about Bill Adler, and I didn't know or think much about what became of him until I walked into a store called Will Leather Goods in Portland, Oregon, while I was on vacation. There were various pictures of the owner on the wall, photos of him starting the business, posing with friends, hunched over a sewing machine, etc. And I was like, holy shit, that's the motherfucker from Van Nuys Boulevard. Well, he goes by William now, and apparently Bill Adler made and sold leather belts on Venice Beach in between gigs in the mid-1970s. He guest starred on Chips and Mork and Mindy and other popular shows of the day, and then garnered leading roles with Crown. When the acting work dried up in the mid-80s, he started his own leather goods company, now with 2 locations in Oregon. It looks like they make some pretty nice stuff, belts, hats, bags. He also gives away school backpacks to kids. The director of the film, William Sachs, is a prolific director of B-movies like Galaxina, the final film of the tragically murdered Playboy playmate Marilyn Chambers. He started making short films, won some awards, and then went to work for Menachem Golem and Yoram Globus at the famed Canon Films, which you can learn more about in the fun and zany documentary Electric Boogaloo. He earned his bones as a fixer of movies, famously reshooting most of Rocky director John G. Alvinson's movie The Gap. He cut an hour out of it, and made Peter Boyle's periphery character into the lead, and renamed the movie Joe. Alvinson wanted to take his name off the movie as his original cut was testing horribly, but then gladly took his director's credit after watching Sachs' redone version, relegating Sachs to the credit of post-production supervisor. Sachs fixed, reshot, and redubbed 7 or so Italian movies for stateside release for Canon, and then went on to a prolific career in B-pictures, exercising his doctoring skills by reshooting much of 1987's Leprechaun and directing Exterminator 2, made famous recently by Red Letter Media. So I can rest easy knowing that a lot of these guys went on to do at least something. They had fulfilling and interesting lives.
And so I guess against my better judgment, I like this movie a lot.
And I found myself watching it probably, I've probably seen this movie 6 or 7 times. It's sort of a comfortable, bad hangout flick that you can return to over and over again. And in a way, it is a little bit of a time capsule. And that's something that I really like in these older films from the 70s. They didn't have any licenses. They were walking around. They were shooting in public. You know, passersby are in the film. And in that way, it's a little bit like a documentary. It's the progenitor of teen hangout pictures without the self-awareness of Linklater's films. But it works. You know, it's got all the titillation and lackadaisical plotting of a far-out night in 1978, and it's the closest thing we're going to get to a time machine. So crack open a beer, dude. Throw this movie on and travel back to a time before COVID masks or readily available STD testing, and experience what your parents might have thought of as a night to remember. Van Nuys Boulevard. Hope you guys check it out. Hey guys, thank you again for watching my channel. Don't forget to render some alms to the poor if you're feeling charitable. And by that I mean comment, like, and subscribe. It helps more than you know. I love doing this, but I could do it a little more if I had a little bit of the money. You're gonna watch Jeremy Johns again?